Hello, and thank you all for being here today as we're getting started for our Sunday, August 1st, morning worship. I want to welcome all the visitors, and thank you all for being here as we're starting our VBS today, so that is why our auditorium looks like the way it does. But if you are visiting with us, we want to have a record of your attendance. We ask that you please fill out a visitor card located on the back of the pew in front of you and pass it to the outside aisle. They will be collected after services. Upcoming, before we get to our announcements, we have some prayer requests. Eddie Furlong, the father of Jamie Burgess, remains in serious conditions from complications with COVID. They have called in the family. For complications. Jacob Coombs is also recovering from COVID. I ask that you please keep him in your prayers. This morning, as you can see, VBS is in full effect. I want to first apologize. I don't know how much air is actually getting to y'all. That is my bad. I'm sorry, but it looks really cool. Okay, but VBS does start tonight and goes through Tuesday from 6 to 8:30 each night. If you are bringing your kids, I ask that you please let us know by either filling out a registration form or registering online. You can go straight to our website. It's at the top of the page. Register online if you want, so that we have a record of who's going to be here tonight. On that note, I ask that each and every person in this auditorium contact three kids, and invite them to VBS tonight. We've put a lot of work into it. I think it's going to be a great show. I think it's going to be great classes, and I think they're going to learn a lot. So I just ask that each person in the auditorium invite three kids. And you're like, hey, I don't know three kids. Go to the city park. I'm sure you pick them up. Don't do that. Upcoming this week, this Wednesday night meal, if you need to sign up for this, it's going to be catered by Tom's Barbecue, and we'll have pulled pork and sides. You must sign up by tonight so you can give the caterer account. The meal will be $4. You can sign up now. Usually we sign up on the other side on that bulletin board. That bulletin board's been covered, but the youth bulletin board is out there, and that's where you'll find your sign-up sheet. Also coming up on Saturday, August 14th, the WOW group and all seniors are invited to a lunch at Patty's in Grand Rivers, Kentucky. The bus will leave the church building at 10 a.m. Saturday morning. There's a sign-up sheet in the foyer. Again, on that bulletin board, you will see a Patty's sign-up sheet. If you have any questions, please see Juan or Brad. Tonight's services will go a little different. Because we have VBS tonight, we will not be having our normal church service. We will still be offering the Lord's Supper. If you want to be here, you can come and watch the skit and help out with VBS and help, you know, shuttle kids around. That would be so grateful for that. But tonight we will not be having our normal church service. We'll be doing VBS songs and a skit and sending the kids to class. Oh, last thing. I need strong men right after services. As soon as amen is said, there is scaffolding located in a classroom over here to my left, your right. We will go get that, and we'll put it up on stage. I didn't want it to be blocking the screen this morning, so I just need help assembling some scaffolding on stage. It's not going to be hard, but especially if we have a lot of help. So right after amen, just follow me, and we'll go get that stuff and put it up. Any other announcements? Anything else? No? Serving us today in our opening prayer will be led by Rodney Newton. Our song leader today will be Brandon Bridges. Our Lord's Supper Devo will be by Jason Arvin. Scripture reader will be Shane Boggess. Our sermon will be brought by David Salisbury. And closing us out in prayer is Juan Nunez. That's all I have. I can't wait for tonight, and I really can't wait for the sermon because I'm excited about it as well. Let's get started.
There is beyond the azure blue, a God concealed from me.
that we should know, who speaks from his inspired word.
There is a God.
God and Father in heaven, we're thankful for the blessings of this day and that we can just come to you through this avenue of prayer. And we're thankful that we can be gathered together here and assembled together without fear of persecution. We pray that our worship will be pleasing to you, that we'll be edified and strengthened by being together here in fellowship here this morning. We ask your blessings upon our upcoming VPS. We pray that and we will teach the truth to some open minds, and it will sink into their hearts. I'm thankful for the blessings of life, for all that we're able to enjoy. We are so thankful for our homes and our families and our food, shelter, and clothing. We know that you're the one who supplies these things, and you're the one who takes care of us, and we thank you for all that you do. And we're especially thankful for the eternal spiritual blessings we have in Christ. We're thankful that Jesus is willing to come to earth and for the example that he lived and that we're able to read about that in your word. We're thankful that he was willing to go to the cross and be the sacrifice for our sins and that in him we have hope of eternal life in heaven with you, and we look forward to that. Pray for our speaker this morning as he brings the lesson. We pray that he will speak in a way that we can understand and be able to apply it to our lives. We're mindful of all those who are sick and not well, and especially the father of Jamie Burgess. We pray that he might get better if it be your will, and that you'll be with their family at this time. As we look forward to the days ahead, we pray that you'll help us to look to you for courage and strength to do those things that will make us good examples of Christ. When we fall short, we ask for your forgiveness. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
When I serve.
hope. One thing we have because of what Christ did for us. He came, he died for us, and we have hope. So, for I received from the Lord, which I have delivered to you, Lord Jesus, the same night which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given his thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat the bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." So let's go ahead and open the bread and we'll give thanks. Father, thank you for this day, allowing us to be here, Father, to worship you. We thank you for your Son who died on the cross, and we take this bread, Father, representing his body. We pray that we remember everything that he has done and given us. In Jesus' name. Secondly, let's pray for the cup. Father, thank you for, again, allowing us to be here. Thank you for your Son, Father, who died on the cross. And we pray that we take this cup that represents your Son's blood, Father, as he died on the cross for our sins. In Jesus' name. There is a plastic bag in the pews. We ask that you put those in there and put them to the side, and someone will come pick them up. Apart from Lord's Supper is a time to give back, a time to remember everything that God has given us and the blessings that he's given us. Let's pray. Father, thank you for, again, allowing us to be here. Father, thank you for everything that you've given us in this life and all the blessings that you have given us, Father. We thank you for having this building that we can worship in and the air and everything that you've given us to make us more comfortable as we do worship you. So we know that we could be anywhere worshiping you. Father, we pray that you be with us as we continue on. Father, we pray that you use the money, that we pray that we use the money, that the giving, that and that we'll use it to further glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hide me away, O Lord.
Hide me away. Today's scripture reading comes from 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 7. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all.
Thank you, Shane. Thank you for being here this morning. Things sure do look a little bit different here. I know we have some folks that are joining us online, and we appreciate you joining us online. Abby has been joining us online for the last 5 weeks. We're glad to have her back. But I know we have an online audience, and just real quickly, I know as numbers have gone up and concerns are kind of increasing right now, certainly that is part of our prayer that this would go away, that God would provide us with the answers we need for this pandemic. But if you're staying home for health reasons, we want you to know that we are glad that you've joined us online. And if you're here in person, at the moment, the current guidelines are if you want to distance, if you need to wear a mask, that's up to an individual thing. And we certainly would encourage you to take all those precautions. We are doing our best to be careful as well. But we're glad we get to be together. And we are glad we've been looking forward to Vacation Bible School now for 2 years. It's been 2 years, over 2 years actually, since we had VBS, and it starts tonight. I love this Sunday. I said in Bible class, for 51 Sundays a year, our youngest members sit in a worship service that is completely geared over their head. Everything is focused on teenagers through adults. And for one Sunday a year, we get to kind of focus our worship service. It's still a worship service, but it's focused on how they learn and how they understand the gospel best. And I am so excited. And we get to tell the kids some Bible stories. And I don't know why my slides are changing on their own. They may keep that up. Maybe it's just to make me speed up. We'll see. That may be a recurring theme. That's all right. We think of Bible stories as for kids, but the truth is they're for all of us. Jesus told parables. The stories that we know in the Bible, they happen to adults. And so stories get our interest in a way. It's going to keep doing that. Okay. Well, we're going to go to Peter here in just a minute, and I don't know how much longer it'll keep that up, but that's okay. Hang with me on that. I set one timer one time, and it's changed all my slides forever. I've got to get that fixed back. And now I lost my place. We'd rather watch a movie about a debate than we would to watch the debate. We'd rather hear about the people that are involved. Thanks, Leland. Just hang with me there. We'd rather hear about the people involved and know the story, because the greatest story ever told is the story of God's involvement with mankind. And we are grateful for his involvement. From creation all the way to the birth of Jesus, God's activity makes some of the most amazing stories, and it's not done. The history books of heaven are still being written, and you and I get to have a place in them. So our kids are going to learn some Bible stories. And I know you have no idea who the first one we're going to cover is. But this week, we're going to talk some about Bible stories. And we'll talk about Peter. Peter was a person who grew up religious. But sometimes we have to unlearn some religious things in order to come to know Jesus. In fact, Peter was called three different times before he actually followed Jesus. He had to be sure. Peter probably disappointed some of his Jewish family whenever he became a Christian, when he followed Christ. And maybe you have some religious teachings that you have to unlearn in order to follow Jesus. And maybe there's some family and you're concerned about what they will say or think. Peter becomes a disciple of Jesus Christ. And he walks on water with the Lord. He gets to preach the first gospel sermon at Pentecost. But it all comes from that moment when he confessed, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." It was Peter who said in Luke chapter 18, verse 28, "See, we've left all and followed you." He says, "Jesus, I left everything behind. I gave it all up because you were worth it. We've left all and followed you." And Jesus makes Peter this great promise. He says, "Assuredly, I say to you, there's no one who's left house or parents or brothers or wife or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who shall not receive many times more in this present time and in the age to come eternal life." Peter's story of faith, of leaving everything for Jesus, is a great encouragement to us. Then we'll also study Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus is known for being short. How'd you like that to be what you are known for? Zacchaeus is the short man in the Bible. But the truth is, he ought to be known for his faith, because Zacchaeus was a pragmatist. He believed in doing what worked. And as he looked around in the world that day when the Romans were in charge, he said, here's what works. Rome is the power. Money is the power. And values are great, but you got to live by what works. And so Zacchaeus was a pragmatist. And then he met Jesus and he discovered that faith makes good sense. That trusting Jesus is actually a good, sound decision to make. I love Zacchaeus because he's a nobody on the radar. Zacchaeus shows up in the scripture. He's not a disciple. He's not sick. Jesus didn't call him. He's a nobody. And then all of a sudden, he becomes a follower of Jesus. He's just a short guy who wants to see Jesus. And he's actually pretty shocked when he finds out that Jesus sees him. He came to God just as he was, a short tax collector stuck in a tree. And Jesus changed him. In Luke chapter 19, Zacchaeus stands up and he says something that would be totally crazy for anybody who had known Zacchaeus for all his life up to that point. Zacchaeus, the guy who believed in money and power, Zacchaeus stands up and he says, see, Lord, look, I give half my goods to the poor, and if I have taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I restore fourfold. Zacchaeus is one who says, wait a minute, this is what makes sense. And look at what Jesus says about him. Jesus turns around and says, today salvation has come to this house. Zacchaeus, you gained something far more than money or power. Today salvation has come to this house because he also is a son of Abraham, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Zacchaeus gets it. There's some things that are worse than being lost, or than being poor and powerless, and that's being lost. The most important thing to Zacchaeus now is to be saved. That salvation has come to his house. We'll talk about Rahab. You thought it was bad for Zacchaeus to be known to be short. Rahab's known for her occupation before she ever came to faith. Nobody knows how tall Rahab was, but they sure do know a lot more about her. What we know, though, doesn't define her. What an understanding of grace and second chances. Rahab is one who didn't grow up in any kind of faith. She didn't grow up in church. She didn't grow up knowing about the Lord. She came to faith as an adult. And when she did, she realized she'd messed up a lot. As she came to believe in the one true God and came to know what he taught and expected in holiness and a way of life, she knew she'd made a lot of mistakes out of ignorance. But after coming to faith in an all-powerful, all-knowing, all-loving God, she discovered that God could love her enough to use her in his plan. She dared to believe that anyone could come to God, that whenever you discover the good news, that is the perfect time to follow the Lord every time. And she dared to believe that all her sins could be forgiven. And in the last half of her life, she stepped into the story of Jesus in an amazing way, so much so that she shows up in the genealogy of Jesus and in the Faith Hall of Fame. So we'll talk some about Rahab as an encouragement to us. Elijah was a faithful prophet of the Lord. Man, Elijah did so many great things. But at some point, he got tired. At some point, he said, God, I'm done. I've done enough. In fact, we read in 1 Kings chapter 19, Elijah goes out into the wilderness, and he came and he sat down under a broom tree, and he prayed that he might die. It's enough, he said. I'm done. It's enough. Now, Lord, take my life, for I'm no better than my father's. Elijah said, I'm out. I've served my time. I'm done. I quit. And later on in verse 10, he explains his decision. He says, I've been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they seek to take my life. He says, God, I've been faithful. I've been faithful in hard times. I've been faithful when nobody else was faithful, and I'm done. I've done enough. I'm ready to quit. But Elijah learned that you don't ever get to retire from serving the Lord. That there's never a time when you're old enough to say, I've done enough and now I can just coast on into heaven. You don't retire from service until God is done with you. He learned how to live faithfully late in life. Elijah learned that there were things you can only do after you've lived a long time in service to God. And so he took on Elisha and began to mentor Elisha. so that Elijah, when he passed on from this life, he also passed on his spirit and his ministry, and it continued even after he was gone. Elijah teaches us how to live faithfully later on in life, how an older generation can teach a newer generation about faith and ministry. We'll take a look at Daniel. Daniel is a man of faith in hard times. Daniel chose to do the right thing. That's what God would expect of any person of faith. And when Daniel chose to do the right thing, you know what happened? People opposed him. They made life hard for him because of his faith. And Daniel said, I'm still going to do the right thing. And people opposed him again. In fact, they passed a law that they really could have called the Daniel Law. And it was just to stop Daniel from practicing his faith. They passed a national law to stop Daniel from practicing his faith. And you know what Daniel did? When he knew the writing was signed, he went home and in his upper room, with his windows open toward Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees 3 times that day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as was his custom since early days. Daniel continued to practice his faith. They made life hard for him. He continued to practice his faith. They made life harder for him, and he continued to practice his faith. And you and I would think at some point that's got to pay off, right? At some point, you've got to see the reward for that. Daniel just keeps praying. He keeps trusting the Lord. You say, you know what, Daniel, just trust God. Things could be worse. And Daniel trusted God, and guess what? Things got worse. They made it harder for him and harder for him. When he breaks that law, he's given a death sentence. It's capital punishment. The mode of execution was, we're going to throw you into a pit, basically, full of hungry lions. And we know what happens next. Except it's not what happens next for Daniel. He trusted God even in a den full of hungry lions. He did the right thing because it was the right thing. He didn't have to understand it all to trust God in it all. And as the pressure increased, so did his trust in the Lord. And he found courage when everyone around him was opposed to him. In fact, Daniel found courage when everything around him wanted to eat him. He trusted God. And God brings him through all of that. We're going to look at Samson. Samson is a hard one for me. He's a man who wasted more talent than most of us will ever have. He threw away more blessings from God than most of us will ever see. And yet he finally learned about redemption, and he even learned about humility. Samson is a rebel. He grew up faithful. He grew up with good, godly parents. They taught him about the Lord. They taught him about right from wrong. And when he grew up and could make his own decisions, even with the blessings of God in his life, Samson says, I want to do what I want to do. I want to go my own way. And so he threw it all away. He made a disaster of his marriage. He broke the hearts of his parents. He was given a leadership opportunity, and he wrecked it. But then he learned it's never too late to come to the Lord. He learned that it's never, that we're never without hope. The sign of Samson's strength that was visible to everyone was his long hair. The sign of Samson's apostasy was his cut hair. And at the end of his life, his hair begins to grow back. And we see that God is faithful, no matter what. That it's never too late to come back to the Lord, even when we've rebelled against everything that God has done for us. And at the end of his life, when Samson needs strength one more time, he turns to God. He comes back to the Lord in faith and asks God for his blessing. Because there's always hope. Those are the Bible stories we're going to study. We'll talk about them with our kids. We'll teach it to them because we believe learning these at a young age is powerful. But also because we believe they're true. We believe the same God who spoke the universe into existence, the same God who gave Samson his strength, the same God who saved Rahab alone. And if you know the story of Rahab's salvation, her house is in the wall of Jericho. The entire wall falls all around the city except for her house. That's how powerful God is. The same God who gave Rahab her courageous faith. The same God who gave Elijah and then Elisha the ability to faithfully work together across generations and to serve God's people. The same God who shut the mouths of the lions while Daniel was in the den with them. The same God who gave Zacchaeus the faith to step out of the shadows, to come out of hiding and give his life to the Lord, and the same God who walked with Peter on the water is the same God who is at work today in this church and in you and in me. The same God who told the greatest story ever told is still writing that story, and you and I have parts to play. That's what Paul means in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. When he says there's diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. There are diversities of activities, but it's the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. You know what he's saying there? We've all got different roles to play in the story of God. Your job and my job may be different, but it's the same God who writes the script. It's the same God who directs the work. And what we do, each one of us, we do for all of us. The manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one, but it's given for the profit of all. So what do I do? If it's the same God that blesses us all in different ways, but calls us all to faithfulness together, the same God who is always faithful to His promise, who gives those different gifts and different ministries, but works in all and for the profit of all, I need to take my part in the greatest story ever. Because God invites you to be a part. You know, one of the reasons I believe in Vacation Bible School is because it is a chance to teach the youngest of us that God loves them and has a plan for their lives. And what an opportunity to give your life to the Lord early and have all that time in service to Him. What an opportunity for God to work in us and among us. So many good things happen when we learn those lessons early. But this morning, I want you to know it's never too late to learn those lessons. However you grew up, if you grew up in faith and you've rebelled against it, if you say, you know what, I have to unlearn a few things in order to learn God's truth, it's never too late. God invites you to be part of His story. Each one of us may have some different experiences. We may come from different backgrounds. We may have different gifts and abilities and talents to serve God with, but we serve the same God. And we all come to the Lord the same way. You have a part to play in the greatest story ever. And while I don't know exactly where your path will take you or how you will serve the Lord, I know how it starts for all of us. It begins with Jesus. That's where our story intersects God's story. And when I believe in God and His Word, when I believe in Jesus as His Son, who came to this earth and lived a sinless life and gave that life on the cross to pay a debt that I could never hope to pay, when I believe that, I'll repent of my sins. God, I'm so sorry when I didn't follow You. Your way was best, and I was wrong. And when I repent of my sins, I'll make that good confession. I believe Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, just like Peter did, just like Christians have done in every generation since, to say, I believe Jesus is the only way I can be saved. And in faith, having repented of my sins and confessed my faith, I'll be baptized to have my sins washed away because I'll do anything God asks of me. And when I meet the blood of Jesus in the waters of baptism and come up out of there a new creation, God adds me to His church. He adopts me as His child. He gives me a part in His story, the greatest story ever told. Maybe this morning it's time for you to begin your part in God's story. Maybe it's time for you to become a Christian, or perhaps this morning you're a child of God and you kind of thought becoming a Christian was it, that was, you know, I became a Christian and now I'm done, and you realize, oh, I have so much work to do. My life is now to be lived for Him, and you say, I need to repent and return. I need to be restored and come back. The invitation of God is always open. If we can help you in any way, won't you come right now as we stand and sing?
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, fly away to a home on God's celestial shore.
Bow with me, please. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we again thank you for the opportunity to assemble together as Christians, Lord, to give honor and glory to you for the many blessings you give us, for the lesson we receive today, Lord, that we carry in our daily in our hearts. Lord, we pray for our vacation Bible school that we're able to reach out to the community and inspire the youth, but also the adults, Lord, as we are here to serve. Lord, that we continue to put you first in our lives and continue to become knowledgeable in the words that have been inspired from the Bible. Lord, continue to, in the things that we say and the things that we do. Guide us and direct us, protect us as we travel the roads, and bring us home safely. In Jesus' name, amen.